And welcome everybody. Let me share my screen here. So I'll give you a little bit of an introduction to my background. We'll talk a little bit about how to deliver a superior student experience while ensuring campus safety in the views of COVID. We'll go through a case study for Florida International University's one-stop center. And then I'll go a walkthrough of some of the technology for mobile wave management, flex deployments, and remote workforce management. I'll show you some data from actual use case studies, and then we'll do some Q&A, and I'll give you my contact info and some resources. So I myself, I came to the US in 1993 to get a degree to get a degree from MIT. I then drove across the country to California to get a PhD at Caltech in neuroscience. And I started QLIS in 2007. And we've now virtualized more than 200 million weights. QLIS was named received the Gold Stevie for the best computer services company in America for six consecutive years from the American Business Awards. For three of the last 5 years from the International Business Awards. So our mission at QLIS is to eliminate waiting in line from the face of the earth. And we have saved our users thousands of years of line, more than all of recorded history since the beginning of writing. You can download our apps for free from the App Store, both on the Apple Store, where it's rated 4.9 out of 5, and the Android Store, where it's rated 4.6 out of 5. And we have well over 100 QLIS colleges and universities that include NYU and University of California, University of Texas, and many others. So let's talk about COVID a little bit. All right, so we're doing this webinar on Zoom, which is one of the game-changing technologies that has really come to the forefront with COVID, and it's also evolving quickly, right? So, for example, Zoom now allows breakout rooms so that classes can break out into smaller groups, have smaller discussions, then come back together for the whole group, and so on. So, so the technology is COVID is really boosting a very rapid development of technology for digitization and remote work, and it's really interesting to watch. Some of the challenges caused by COVID include obviously the safety of the community, operating with legacy systems and processes in a virtual environment. How do you deliver a superior student experience while maintaining social distancing? You get all these influx of appointment requests due to unique circumstances because of what's going on. Then the coordination of staff working remotely and the oversight of staff working remotely. And so, in order to align operations with student expectations, you need accessibility to critical student services regardless of current circumstance. You need visibility into wait times and appointment availability. You need prompt service in a virtual or social distance environment. And you need to continue to deliver an exceptional student experience even under these trying times. So how do you leverage technology to support campus operations to provide a seamless transition from a physical environment to a remote or social distance environment? How do you provide load balancing to distribute incoming student requests and needs to a workforce that is increasingly remote? How do you provide increased visibility and predictability for staff and effective management of walk-ins and appointments? And how do you keep staff morale high in the face of all of these changes and challenges, right? Social distancing has reduced the capacity of people in populated areas. So you want to implement virtual engagement models wherever possible and maintain service levels in a virtual environment. And this impact is here to stay. Remote learning and service delivery models are here to stay. Digital transformation is critical to growth and scale, and community safety will remain a top priority, even as cases start going down in regions of the world where they're still increasing. Fear will remain well past the actual risk, and this is likely not the last pandemic to hit us. So Florida International University's one-stop shop has a full-time enrollment of more than 33,000 students, provides assistance with transcripts, enrollment, classes, residency, financial aid, and more. And during the peak season, it serves about 800 students per week. Previously, I'd worked with a competitor and had challenges with text message delivery, with system uptime, wait times of over 30 minutes. Students often joined the wrong line and or didn't have the necessary information when they got to the front of the line. And so they went through an evaluation process, developed a new model for student intake and service, and launched a mobile queue management system. The result was that average wait times on site went down, line abandonment rates went down, average wait times decreased from more than 30 minutes to 15 minutes, and line abandonment rates decreased from roughly 30% to 10% or less. So how does it all work? It's a very omni-channel experience. So a student can download the QLS app on Android or an iPhone. They can also use a mobile browser to use QLS. They can also send a text message. They can use a desktop browser. They can use kiosks on site and monitors to monitor the place in line. They can even make phone calls into a system, and universities can even use the QLS APIs to integrate into their own apps and systems. When a student starts the QLS experience, they'll see the wait time for each and the number of students in line for each of the services. And they're able to either get in line for it or make an appointment for a particular day and time that's more convenient. At that point, the first time they'll enter their phone number. After that, the system will remember it, and they'll be able to select the kind of appointment they want, the day of their appointment, enter optional notes, et cetera. This can be optionally customized to include employee number, students, email address, et cetera. And once they're in the line, they'll get a real-time wait forecast that updates in real time. And they'll get the ability to make changes, right? They're able to push themselves back in the line if they need more time and won't make it in time, converting a no-show into a later show. They're able to leave the line and allow the next student to be called automatically so that there's no time wasted waiting for him or her. They're able to get directions to the right place to be served and so on. This is how it works if you're using text messages instead of the app. You can see that you can enter the name of the line you're trying to join. You get options for some of the different queues available for service. And once you select a one, such as badging, key card, then you enter, you fill in whatever information is needed, in this case, name, you get updates. Your estimated wait is now 7 minutes. We'll let you know when you reach the front. And this is a predictive summoning that will summon students before their turn is ready so that they can show up just in time for service. In fact, our Android app will even provide a notification that takes into account current traffic so they can arrive in time based on where they are. This is the way to do it if you're inside and when you use a kiosk, whether it's on-site or through a website. And again, it allows the student to enter their information, including potentially an ID number, and then it provides real-time information of the number of students in line for each service and the wait time. And then the student can select which one they want to get in line for. You can even select the type of service within that, the type of transaction they'd like to do, so that the staff member is prepared for that service, or so it can be routed to the right staff member. In fact, one of the things that QLS does, it will solve the matching problem of figuring out which staff member can solve each student's problems. Right? So when a staff member hits next to see the next student, QLS will automatically call the first student in line that can actually be serviced by that staff member, whether it's because they speak the right language or the staff member is trained to carry out the transaction, et cetera. And there's actually more than one option, right? So the student will have the option to join the line to be seen as soon as possible, and they'll get a real-time wait forecast for that. Or alternatively, if this is not a good time or the wait is too long for them right now, they can schedule a flex appointment for another day and time. And what a flex appointment is the ability to, so the student experience at the front end is very much like that of a traditional appointment. You select a day and a time for service, and these availabilities update in real time based on what students are doing anywhere. But flex appointments, how many times have you been to an appointment and still had to wait even though you had an appointment? And the reason for that is that it's impossible to have an appointment that's scheduled days or weeks in advance to be accurate in the face of tremendous variability in the duration of each actual service transaction, right? Each student gets seen for a different amount of time for different kinds of services. And so it's very hard for a fixed length appointment to capture that variability, let alone no-shows, delays, people who show up late, et cetera, variability in the staff, and so on. So we've solved that the way that people solve it in real life. If you're meeting your significant other and you're going to be late, you don't leave them standing in the rain, you know, in the corner of Piccadilly Circus. You text them and let them know, honey, I'm going to be 20 minutes late. Let's meet 20 minutes later. And then both arrive just in time to meet. So Flex Appointments is a platform to allow colleges, universities, and other establishments to do that at scale automatically. So Flex Appointments update bi-directionally in real time as your staff and students' availability changes. So it might be QLIS telling a student, hey, we know you wanted to be seen at 3, but it looks like we're running a little late. We won't be ready until 3:20. Or conversely, a student who gets stuck in traffic or in a class that goes late can push themselves back and say, you know what, I'm not going to make it by 3. I need to be there at 3:30. And QLIS will automatically refill that spot with somebody else who gets happy to be seen earlier and have a shorter wait. And then both of those systems, the wait management and the Flex Appointments, are seamlessly integrated. So somebody who cancels a Flex Appointment gets replaced automatically with somebody in the wait list. Somebody joining the wait list, their wait forecast will take into account upcoming Flex Appointments and so on. So let's switch over to a different challenge that's going on with COVID, right? With so many services happening remotely and so many staff members working remotely, how do you know, how do you oversee that staff remotely? And so that's where QLIS Dashboard comes in. What you can see here is that Dashboard provides real-time information and sends real-time alerts to management's mobile phones with the current wait for each service, the number of students waiting, the number of students being served right now, the number of students served today, the wait time, both median, maximum, minimum, transaction times, median, minimum, and maximum. And then you can look at the same thing by queue and look at how that varies by for each of the queues. And so it allows you to see, to essentially manage things in real time and identify areas that are understaffed and may have longer than usual wait times so that additional staff can be summoned to serve there. Or areas where there's too many students and waiting and so on and so forth. But it also allows you to see productivity by staff member, right? So you can look at what's the employee utilization rate? How many of your employees are actually seeing students right now and have been throughout the day? And how many are idle? How long has each of them been idle? How many students did they serve today? How many transactions have they carried out? And what was the medium transaction duration? And so that allows essentially the same sort of management that you would have if you had everybody on site in the same room, no matter where people are working from, which allows you to increase your employee utilization rate, decrease student wait times, increase student satisfaction, reward best performers, and so on and so forth. Staff is a large expense. And so, what's the value of staff being 10% more efficient, right? And it's a lot. When you're trying to make a decision, do you need to spend money hiring new staff, or do you need to spend money training your staff to be more efficient, and so on and so forth. One of the interesting things about technology these days is that it provides an unprecedented amount of data that allows you to make actionable decisions. So for example, how long are your students waiting? Are the wait times really short so that you really don't need to hire that extra staff member? Are the wait times really long so that, and where are they longest so that you can decide where to spend that critical open hiring slot? What are the outcomes? How many of the students quit the line or the queue while they're waiting and never get service? How many of the students return back or never come back? How many service transactions are performed by each employee or staff member? What are the delays between when a student is called for service and when they actually show up? What's the service duration by employee, by queue, and so on. So that kind of data isn't valuable when you're trying to make decisions. So this shows you data from one QLS institution showing that 86% of QLS users choose mobile queuing as opposed to just deciding to wait on site, staring at a monitor. So there's very high adoption, and it increases over time as the users get familiar with the platform. And this shows the average delay between when a student gets summoned and when they actually get served. In blue are students using their phone with QLS. In red are students who are just pulling a ticket and waiting on site. In green are students who join the line remotely, whether it's from home or anywhere else. What you can see is, number one, the green is not really higher than the blue. So joining line remotely does not mean that students take longer to show up. And that's because QLS has kept them informed and engaged throughout their wait and pre-summon them so they show up in time for their time to be seen. But the other thing you can see is that the people who are using the phone service of QLS actually have a lower delay to show up than the people who are using a ticket. That might seem initially counterintuitive when you think that somebody with a ticket is presumably on site and should take a shorter time to show up. But the point is that students get impatient and they leave and they sometimes don't show up at all, or they are far away and don't find out, or they get surprised by the time they get called and then they're in the middle of doing something or in the middle of some homework. Whilst QLS has kept them engaged and informed throughout with real-time wait forecasts that update throughout the wait, so that they are prepared and ready when the time comes. And mobile queuing also reduces no-shows with respect to tickets. Here you can see it, no-show rates going down by significant percentage, about 16% with the students in blue that are actually using their phones versus a ticket. And that's because students are essentially, on the one hand, you can convert a no-show into a later show because you give the student a chance to push themselves back in the queue and get seen later if it's an inconvenient time. And secondly, because the text messages and the notifications really act as a digital tether to pull the student back into the office for service when you're ready to serve them, even if they had left before. And so I think the overall conclusion is, these are challenging times, but they're also times of opportunity to really improve processes in a way that is really here to stay beyond the time of COVID. Because all of these tools and technologies are better in pandemic times and out of pandemic times, right? Nobody wants to stand in line. Nobody wants to wait in a waiting room. Everybody has something better to do with their time, namely get an education in the case of students. And so if you provide tools that allow students more convenience, that allows staff members more efficiency, that improves staff morale because they're not dealing with angry students who had just spent an hour waiting in a waiting room, but rather came just in time for service and they feel respected. I can tell you, I've read a review on Yelp for a student who graduated from West LA College in Los Angeles, California. And as they wrote their review of the college after their multi-year student experience, three things came to mind as the highlight of their educational experience. And one of them was that the college had invested in technology, including QLS, to make her student experience better. And so these kinds of things really make a lasting impression on students. They say there's never a second chance to make a first impression. And the first impression of any student with an educational experience is their wait experience. So with that, let me open it up for questions and also provide you with my email address, which is alex@qls.com. And I'd be happy to answer any questions there as well. So let me open it up.
Thank you so much. I think the graphs that you show really are really striking, and it's very clear how well this works. And I think, as someone who spends great deal of time studying, I think a lot of the time was also spent just wasting time trying to get to talk to administrators. So I definitely wish I had known about this when I was in college. So we have a lot of questions coming in. So Let's start with this one. This, I think, is quite interesting. So someone is asking, is technology a risk for employment? And especially talking about, you know, working with staff and using technology to kind of enhance that.
Yeah, that's a great question. I don't think so. I think it's an opportunity for employment. When you allow education to continue working remotely in times where otherwise people would not be allowed to go into school at all, you're actually saving jobs. QLIS doesn't serve the students. It doesn't replace the job that staff members do to serve the students. It just matches students to staff members at the right time, so that that experience is more seamless, so there's not a wait. But the actual services, the registration, admission, financial aid, that's still being done by people. And in addition, there's jobs created from people who are implementing technologies. And so I think that technology provides an opportunity to have staff be doing more value-add jobs, right? Rather than low-value jobs like telling students how long they're going to have to wait.
No, that makes a lot of sense, and that ties into another question that we have. Where do you see the biggest potential for this technology going forward? Right. So this is what you've done so far. Where next?
So one of the shifts we've seen during COVID is more and more queues for video service, for callback service, right? So the queues are not just for in-person service, but for digital services as well. So I think that's one area of a lot of growth. I think the remote workforce management is an area of a lot of growth too. I think in education, we see QLIS being used for admissions, advisement, registration, financial aid, counseling. But we also see it outside of education in government services, at the local, county, state, and federal service. We see it in retail, where increasingly there's quotas for the number of the maximum number of people who can be in a store at any given time, and that creates waits outside. And the last thing you want is you're keeping people outside of the store to prevent overcrowding, and then you're crowding them all in a queue right outside the door. That's really right. The last thing you want. It's a terrible way to meet with all customers. So those are some areas, but QLIS is being used also in restaurants and bowling alleys, in urgent cares and hospitals, in ports for truck queues. So it's really anywhere where people wait. And really, it doesn't even need to only be people queues. It can be document queues, right? If you want to let your student know where is your application in the process, so that you are reducing these calls to find out, hey, did you lose my application? What's going on? And these students are able to get real-time updates of, hey, you're number 37 in the queue, you're number 35 in the queue. We expect you to get an answer in 17 days and so on.
So have you seen more adoption of QLIS during COVID, given this phenomenon?
Big time. We have seen over 300% increase in bookings over the last few months since COVID started.
That's amazing. And what has been the biggest learning you've had, both recently and just in general in your work?
What is the biggest learning? I think one interesting one has been, people often ask us at the beginning, is this something that just a few students will use? Is that sort of for like a few sort of tech savvy students and everybody else keep doing the same thing? And the answer has inevitably at everyone, we have thousands of locations using QLIS, and at everyone, everybody starts using QLIS because there's really no disadvantages, no advantage to have people continue to stand in line when they can do something that they really can get, that it's so easy to use and it's better. And so one of the lessons has been that there's 100% adoption, which I think has really helped, because I think anytime you have a choice of doing something or not, it gets a little harder and you need to make that decision, and you may see people standing in line and you just assume that that's the way to do things and you just do what you've always done, stand in line. But as soon as you see that there is no line and no queue, then students very quickly pick up what the new way of doing things is and use it all. So I think that's been one of the lessons. The other one, sometimes people ask us, how long does it take to deploy something like this? And it's really up to the college or university. I remember a few years ago, you know, I'm in California, and we're famous for our fires. And a few years ago, there was a fire in Sonoma County, and Sonoma County was in the queue to be launched, to launch queue list. And they called in one Saturday and said, hey, we have a line of people outside the door because of the fires. Is there any way we could launch sooner than expected? And we launched it that same Saturday. So it really is, you know, that's the beauty of software as a service and web-based services is, you know, all we need to do is create an account for you. You know, staff logs in and starts using it. So it really can be launched very quickly. I guess, you know, a third type of question that comes up is, you know, is this something that requires a big budget? And the beauty about, again, web-based services is you really don't need any hardware, right? You can let students use their phones that they already have. And so it can really be extremely affordable. It's priced based on student count. So small colleges can afford it just as well as large colleges. So those are some of the lessons that come up. You know, a lot of it also has been learning how to partner with educational institutions in a way that works best for them. For example, how to price it in ways that makes it easy for colleges and universities to budget for it. And I guess the last one is how global of a problem is this? People have been standing in queues, lines since the time of the pharaohs in ancient Egypt, and so it's a tradition or a custom or a technology, if you want, because it's a very ancient technology that would replace crowds scrambling for service. That has been around for so long that it's spread to every continent and pretty much every industry. And so we find it has really universal applicability. And so we have people using it in Barcelona, people using it in Melbourne, Australia, people using it in Alaska. It's all the universal need of people valuing their time.
Right. I mean, I think living in England, queuing being sort of a national sport, it's definitely very clear how this could just change our lives, especially we're here. I guess a question that for me is quite striking of the ones that are here has to do with the universities that are struggling. And there are quite a few universities in the States that are currently a bit strapped for cash because of the pandemic. Is this sort of a group of universities that you're helping? Is this something that you're interested in? Or how could QLIS help these universities?
Yeah, we always look to help out in any way we can. There's a variety of different programs sort of available for every budget. And really, I mean, a lot of the universities get paid based on the number of students that they're able to serve, whether they're private or public. At the end of the day, there is accountability in terms of the number of students served. And QLIS reduces student dropouts. We've had Collin College saw a 1,500% increase in student engagement. You heard right, 1,500% increase in student engagement, right? When you are communicating with your students to their cell phone, to their mobile phone, which is their primary communication device, you're able to keep them engaged, ask them questions, find out why they didn't complete their registration. I remember interviewing a student at West LA College a few years ago. We had some visitors from the UK actually, and from Nepal and other places, and we went to show them the QLIS installation there. And one of us had a QLIS jersey on. And so a student approached us. She was a little bit of an older adult student. And she said, thank you so much for implementing QLIS here. She said, you know, usually I find technology befuddling. I remember her word. But QLIS is really easy to use. And there was something that struck me about this woman. And so I approached her and asked her, you know, tell me a little more. You know, why do you typically find technology befuddling? What is it about QLIS that you like so much? And she said, she leaned in and whispered in my ear and said, well, I just spent 30 years in prison. And so you can imagine somebody who's just had, you know, their, you know, 30 years of their life taken away by the penitentiary system, they're going to value their time more than anybody in the world. And, you know, if it's really like a time traveler, right? It's like somebody who's come back from the past from 30 years ago. And imagine, you know, when they went in, we didn't have cell phones and we didn't have laptops. They're coming out and dealing with a whole new world. And so for a student like that to tell us that she found Keyless easy to use was really a testament that it can be used by anyone. But what was most interesting to me was she was saying, you know, I often have to, you know, I work two jobs. And so, you know, I couldn't afford to stand in line for an hour. I wouldn't be able to study if I had to do that first for, you know, admissions and then financial aid and then registration. But with Keyless, I'm able to stand in all of those queues virtually at the same time, be summoned for the first available one, then show up for the next one. And so when you think about those students, which are the students in a way most at risk of dropping out, Keyless really allows them, gives them an experience that allows them to not have to drop out. And so I think going back to your question about budgets, right? If you can avoid those students from dropping out because of having a Keyless experience, you're potentially also increasing your budgets. And so I think it pays for itself, even in addition to obviously the heartwarming aspect of helping a student like that.
No, for sure. And I think from our previous sessions as well, it's the big question is how to innovate, how to change, how to adapt as a university to maintain student engagement when you don't have the physical aspect of going to school, which especially, I mean, over here in the UK and in the US, there's such a big aspect of being on campus, being present, and anything that can help without also having a really big cost is definitely welcome. So we have a question more about yourself and your journey. And someone is asking, if you had to give yourself advice when you just started, what would it be?
Ooh, there's a lot of lessons you learn along the way. The most important one is choose your spouse carefully, but choose your partners even more carefully. you know, partners are forever. And so, you know, you really want to due diligence and reference check, not just the people you're thinking of bringing into your board of directors, but even their partners, you know, so that you are bringing in partners that share your goals, share your morals and ethics, your values. So it's probably the biggest one. Secondly, you know, stay close to your customers, right? You know, you showed at the beginning, Karen, of your slides, you know, the funding raised by startups came from your accelerator. And, you know, funding is great, but funding doesn't last forever, right? Funding is a temporary reprieve until you manage to make something valuable enough that your customers are paying for it on an ongoing basis. And so there's really no substitute for solving a customer's needs and problems to earn real revenues to fund the operations. And I think that's always the best way, is to stay close to your customers and follow their needs. Funding can give you, you know, an ability to pay the bills without satisfying your customers that can be you know, misleading. So I think that would be a second one. Those are the first two that come to mind.
I guess one last question would be, you've been working so closely with all these universities during these hard times. What do you see as the biggest challenge going forward? So we've had already 6 months of COVID, a lot has changed. What's next?
I think the first thing that's next, so I've actually done a lot of COVID scientific research myself. My PhD is in biology. And so earlier this year when COVID struck, I actually sort of took a sabbatical and spent a couple of months doing research on COVID and published a number of preprints about it. I was the first to discover that sunlight makes a big difference to COVID spread, both to infection and to fatality of people infected. And so I think that one of the things that's ahead is the Northern Hemisphere is about to get a lot more cases and a lot more deaths as the days get shorter. And so that's obviously an unpleasant development. On the other hand, I think things are gonna get better for the Southern Hemisphere as we turn into their summer solstice. I think things will start to get better as we emerge out of the darkness in the Northern Hemisphere, you know, starting next, March and beyond. I think one of the factors that made this pandemic as bad as it was is we were at a solar minimum this year. And so that was, and it was a really, really low solar minimum across, you know, hundreds of years. And so that we're coming out of that now. And so things will get better next year and beyond. But then there will be another solar minimum, in 10 years or a similar amount of time. And so we need to be prepared for the next pandemic. And I think we need to be prepared to share data globally much more quickly than we've shared this time so that we can very quickly apply algorithms to the data that emerges globally on what makes a particular virus thrive or not thrive in each environment, so that we can use that to decide on policy better, for example, right? So if the data that came out of my research and then of others around the importance of sunlight and vitamin D in COVID had spread globally faster, perhaps we would have had people who were quarantined take a little more sunlight and or take some doses of vitamin D rather than just spend their time in the darkness. And so I think it's very important to have that kind of like rapid global sharing of data around the speed of transmission of a disease as well as the fatality rates, so that these trends can be identified quickly and then spread globally, because a lot of this information is still not well known globally. And I think that the next challenge will be the challenge of, as things start going back to normal, that whole transition, and how do you make sure you don't get new spikes during that? How do you manage that transition back seamlessly?
That's super interesting. And we have a question related to this, kind of responding to what you just said. Someone is asking, about Brazil, about COVID in Brazil and sunlight, if you had any insight on that, and like, South America has been especially hard hit.
Yeah, absolutely. So, Brazil is actually an excellent example of what I'm talking about. So first of all, sunlight is not the only factor, right? Brazil's government's response to COVID has been particularly pathetic. They ignored the disease for far too long. And so that's part of the what's going on in Brazil. The second thing I'd say is if you compare Germany, where a lot of the right measures were taken early on, to Brazil, where everything was done wrong early on, the fact that there was more sunlight in Brazil than in Germany made the initial spread in Brazil actually slower than the initial spread in Germany, which is incredible. So sunlight did more initially than government response. Now, over time, that changes. And one of the things that changed in Brazil is that the winter came. And so right now it's winter time. But the last thing I'd say about Brazil is, Brazil is a huge country and it's not uniform. And there are areas that get a lot of clouds and a lot of rain, such as Manaus in the Amazon jungle. And Manaus has been a hotbed for COVID like few. It has been a disaster. So the variability of COVID spread within Brazil has been very good evidence for this, this finding that sunlight makes a difference.
That's really interesting. And it's, I think it's something that we don't get to hear so much in the news, especially over here, about these local differences, but it will definitely give everyone something to think about. I think we've basically talked about everything today, and I'm very grateful. Thank you so much for being here and for your time and for showing us your solution for this problem that is pervasive, but we don't really talk about it as much in the education world. It gets a bit disregarded over others.
Thank you, Karen. Yeah, I really appreciate it. Yeah, if there's one way to kill a business is to physically kill its customers or students, right? And so I think that physical safety needs to come first, and I think a platform for social distancing can really help with that. I did want to point out there's a whole bunch of different resources available on the QLS website, including booklets on 12 ways to satisfy your students while they wait, and a case study for the university in Australia. Another one for Broward College, the one on Collin College and student engagement increase that I mentioned about, a financial aid case study for Velosa State University, and a number of others. So feel free to check them out at QLS.com.
Great. These are some amazing resources, and we'll share them with some of the people that we know as well. Thank you. Thank you to our audience for being here today. And have a great day, everyone.
Thank you, Karen.